ever. And today the Creighton Blue Jays host the Georgetown Hoyas on the Big East Digital Network presented by SoFi. Here are the Big East standings. As you see, DePaul locked in at the one seed. Marquette probably in at the two, but Rob Sims, 3 through 7 up for grabs.
3 through 7 up to grabs. Absolutely a tight race. All-important race because you don't want to finish in those bottom four. If you can finish in the top six, you get that first round bye, and that's what Creighton is looking to do today.
Welcome here to the floor at DJ Sokol Arena. John Schreiner, Rob Sims will be with you for all the action today. Rob, these two teams kind of on opposite ends of the spectrum this season. Creighton, they've made a good run here down the stretch. Georgetown has really faltered over their last 14 games.
Yeah, Creighton in a must-win situation. They're looking ahead to the NCAA tournament. They have to win today if they want to keep their at-large bid alive. Georgetown, on the other hand, they just want to feel good. They want to keep competing. They just want to come away with a win, which has been hard to come by for them this year.
Meanwhile, it's senior day here in the building for Creighton. A couple of seniors will be honored. Jaylyn Agnew, one of those, nearly 20 points a game for the senior.
One of the leading candidates for Big East Player of the Year. We've got all kinds of stats about her that we're going to share throughout this ball game.
Got an important game. Creighton trying to find their way into the top four. And they do it with a win over Georgetown. We'll find out. The tip-off is next. Back with you here at DJ Sokol Arena, just ahead of the tip-off between the Hoyas and the Blue Jays. Noon central tip-off for the men. Excuse me, it's an 11 central tip-off for the Creighton men. Women get it going here in the building at home for the 1 o'clock tip. Take a look at the lineups in this one. Brianna Jones, Cassandra Gordon, Marvelous Osagie Arese, Anita Kalava and Taylor Barnes. Creighton sees this lineup. It's a little bit shorthanded for the Hoyas here in the late season.
Yeah, a couple of players opting to enter the transfer portal here just within the last 10 days or so. They lost three players, two of which were in their rotation, typical minutes, and they decided that they wanted to enter the transfer protocol or the portal. So a little shorthanded today, but talking to coach and those involved with the program, doesn't really change their rotation all that much. And you know what? You got to go with the hand you're dealt with, and they're going to go with the players that are dressed out today.
Let's take a look at the lineup for the Creighton Blue Jays. It's a familiar one if you've watched the Creighton women this season. Tatum Rembau, Temi Sarda, Olivia Elger, Jaylyn Agnew, Gracie Griglione is how they will line it up.
Special day here for Elger and Agnew on senior night. Not only senior day for those two, but fifth year seniors, each of them redshirting. Elger had a medical redshirt as a sophomore, and Agnew came in. They could see how special she was going to be. They didn't see a lot of minutes in the rotation her first year on campus, so she redshirts, and my goodness, look how it has paid off for the Blue Jays. Leading the Big East in scoring this year is Agnew.
There's Jim Flannery, 18th season as the head man. 345 wins, all-time wins leader in program history. He's looking to ride this thing out, get a 4 seed for the Big East tournament. On the other side, James Howard, now in his third season, 40-55. They were WNIT quarterfinalists a year ago, Rob.
Yeah, and they've back-to-back appearances in the WNIT. Coach Howard's first two seasons there in D.C., so he had thought they had righted the ship a little bit. They finished 9-9 in the Big East last year, fourth in the conference. But looking into this season, he lost some all-conference players, Deanna White, Dorothy Adamako. Those are some tough names to replace. And as evidenced by the 5-23 record, it's been a tough go to replace those players. And talking with Coach, he talked about where he knew going into the season, where am I going to find my offense? Where am I going to find my offense? Well, you look at it right now, they're last in the league in offense. So they've had a hard time replacing those players.
Agnew and Calava to jump it up. Agnew wins the tip. Blue Jays will begin with the basketball. Thank you so much for joining us here on the Big East Digital Network. Inside to Agnew, turnaround, jumper is good. Jaylyn Agnew off to a hot start on senior day.
Well, that gets her within 10 points of 1,500 in her career. What an outstanding career, former Big East Freshman of the Year, and looking to secure the Big East Player of the Year this year.
That's Calava, called for the travel early on. Anita Calava, a 6'3 forward out of Zagreb, Croatia. Rimbaugh will bring it ahead for the Blue Jays. Hand off, Agnew. Straight on three. Bang! Jaylyn Agnew with five quick points out of the gate.
You think these fans aren't going to miss that shot and that take from this player who has just been outstanding in her career.
At the other end, a good drive for Osagi Aresi. 5-2, Blue Jays still in front. Creighton picked fourth in the league standings at the outset. Trying to finish in that spot. Rimbaugh on the drive. Wild hook shot. Doesn't get close, and Gordon there for the rebound. Gordon's a player that James Howard targeted and said he wanted to see what she was going to look like. Would her effort be there heading into next year?
Mentioned a couple players that have seen the growth, and it's tough when you're going through a 2-15 conference record, which they have right now. It's tough to keep fighting, but he has pointed out a few players that he has really been impressed with and proud of the way they have continued to grow despite the struggles to find those wins.
Sarda was cut off by Osagi Aresi. And then the entry pass from Agnew was touched out of bounds, but a foul called.
Yeah, they're going to call a hold on Brianna Jones. There's, you mentioned that pass to the cutter went out of bounds because of that hold.
Fresh 20 on the shot clock for the Blue Jays. Good feed from Agnew. Awkward looking shot from Griglione, but she's able to make it work.
Yeah, she even had a little shrug coming down the court there. It looked like when she released it, she was halfway between wanting to go straight on or wanting to put it in off the glass. But either way, good result for the Blue Jays.
7-2 Creighton early. Barnes gives it up. Calava down to the block. Missed it. Here's Agnew from the right wing. Skips it out. Sarda for three. Just missed it. And touched out of bounds. It'll be Jaylyn Agnew who hit it last.
Fighting for that long rebound.
Jaylyn Agnew now bordering on 1,500 points and 600 rebounds for her career. She would be the 11th Creighton Blue Jay to reach the 1,500 point scoring mark in a career. On the drive, Barnes missed it, tapped out. Agnew out and running.
Agnew with the chance, too, to become the first Blue Jay to average 20 points in a season in 30 years.
And there's a three from the left side from Tatum Rimbaugh. She's fired up. 10-2.
Agnew not just a scorer. She gets the assist on that one. Finds her open teammate. Rimbaugh knocking it down.
Turnover into the hands of Elger. Didn't have the number she wanted, so she'll set the offense.
This motion offense that Coach Flannery has run here for 18 seasons. Tough to guard against, everybody almost positionless out there.
Bounce feed, good one. Sarda couldn't handle it, and it's taken away. Lobbed inside for Calava. Stuck on the baseline, outside, extra pass. There's a three from Gordon, she got it. Good shot from Cassandra Gordon.
Yeah, great transition there by the Hoyas. Got Creighton sucked underneath. A little too many defenders on Kalava. Kalava kicks it out. That extra pass after that one. Getting it into the hands of Gordon for the bucket.
Gordon just a 27% three-point shooter. Sunk that one, and then at the other end, Jaylyn Agnew is going to draw the contact.
Talked about Elger and Agnew, seniors here. Fifth-year seniors ideally playing in their last home game. Now there's the opportunity, of course, if they don't get that at-large bid, that they could be in the NIT. They definitely will be in the NIT, whether they get a home game or not will be determined. One more senior that is playing in her final game with the Blue Jays, Morgan Turner, a transfer from Lipscomb, only played 27 games last year.
Agnew's three off the rim. Rebound pulled out of there by Tayana Jones, who's into the game.
And Turner just not able to fight through injuries to play this year, but she is dressed today, expected to see the court for a few seconds at the least.
Almost stripped away by Elger, but it creates an opportunity for Brianna Jones. And off the offensive rebound, a miss by Wright. Creighton has it back the other way.
Mikel Parham, the freshman, showing off her size. She matches up well against the size of Georgetown, and then an unforced error by the Jays.
And now just a little too far out in front for Rachel Saunders, the sophomore out of Iowa City. Creighton team that only turns it over 11 times per game. One of the best in the country.
Fifth in the nation in turnovers per game, seventh in total turnovers.
Here's Wright to the left. The Memphis transfer, Taylor Barnes, a graduated senior. Jones, good. Brianna Jones with a bucket. 10-7, Georgetown fighting back a little bit.
Creighton got off to that hot start. They haven't had as many good looks on the offensive end the last few trips down. Credit Georgetown making those adjustments.
More than 2 minutes without a score for Creighton. Saved up in the air. Did Kalava get it? Oh, excuse me, not Kalava. That's out of bounds, and that's going to get us to the media timeout. Into the hands of Tayana Jones. Georgetown fighting back within three. Here are the scores in progress in the other Big East women's basketball games. Providence and Villanova locked in a tight one in the third quarter. Seton Hall with a 9-point lead on Butler. The other two coming up later this afternoon.
And we could go through
bunch.
And we could go through all the scenarios about seeding, right? With the 4-10-7 teams coming in here, but that might take the entirety of this ball game to explain it all.
Every result seems to depend on another. Agnew with the three, got it. Second three of the first quarter for Jaylyn Agnew. And it's 13-7 Creighton.
Great play drawn up by Coach Flannery out of the timeout to get Agnew curling around there, find herself open at the top of the key.
Is right. Taylor Barnes with it. Tayana Jones on the drive. Good dish inside. And an easy finish for Tayana Jones.
Nice feed there, drawing the defenders towards the dribble penetration, collapsing and getting it into the hands of Shania Wright.
8 points for Agnew. Attacks. She's fouled. She'll go to the free throw line. And here's your Rob Sims statistical moment.
You hesitate to use the word automatic, but when you're 38 of 38 in Big East play, that's the definition of automatic, right? 100% of her shots she has made from the free throw line in Big East play this year.
That's 45 straight overall. 38 of 38 now, 39 of 39 against the Big East. If she goes perfect from the line today, it would be the Big East record.
She could even slip and miss one and still get the Big East record. That record is currently 963 at the free throw line.
Well, that's already 10 points for Jaylyn Agnew.
She wanted to get to 1,500 quick.
Mid-range jumper missed. Offensive board for Georgetown and a foul.
See who that goes on there. Three Blue Jays smothering Jones there. She comes away with the offensive rebound. Got it on Saunders there.
That puts Tayana Jones at the free throw line where she's not been great. Just 7 of 17 on the season. That's 41%. She coolly strokes the first one.
She had a good game against the Blue Jays the first time these teams met. She only averages 5.5 points per game, but 5 for 7 from the field for 11 points the first time these teams met, which saw Georgetown ahead by 10 at halftime, by the way.
Jones 2 for 2 on the trip. Georgetown within 4. Good cut from Agnew, but a great defensive play to touch the pass away. Tayana Jones, 3 from Elger is good. And boy, when the Blue Jays are shooting it from outside like this, Rob, it's tough for any team in the country to beat them.
If anybody's knocking down 67% of your three-pointers, yeah, it's tough to beat, especially when you get going at home on a roll.
Anna Jones. Barnes. Jones with the baseline jumper. Goes in and out. Tough break.
Jones coming off a career night, 24 points Friday night.
Straight down the middle of the floor, Temi Sarda with the bucket.
We talked about the ability of Creighton to knock down those threes, so you have to get down quickly and protect the perimeter, but if you don't stop the lane, stop the drive, Creighton's certainly capable of getting to the rim as well.
Gordon into the corner for Jones. Good baseline drive, tried to throw it back into the post, but Parham was there.
Yeah, leaving your feet to pass, never ideal, especially when you pin yourself underneath the bucket.
Agnew now, 2 points from 1,500. Parham, turnaround, off the glass, a little offline, and it's out of bounds to Georgetown.
Yeah, Parham working hard there, the freshman for the Blue Jays. Gives them their most size when she's out there on the floor. 6'2", 6'3", the freshman from Burnsville, Minnesota, was doing a good job there to establish herself. She was asking for that ball in the low post. Gives you a little glimpse of the future of what Creighton might have in the post there.
Yeah, the other freshman onto the floor as well. Carly Batchelor, you saw a glimpse of her, and now Peyton Brodsky checking in with Parham going to the bench. Here's Barnes, crossover. It's down low. Good finish from Taylor Barnes.
Barnes, the leading scorer for this squad, averages better than 12 points per game. The transfer, grad transfer from Memphis, has really made an impact for this Hoya squad.
Saunders. Underneath. Good finish for Batchelor. Even better pass from the sophomore Saunders.
And those cutters, if you don't stay with the Blue Jays on this motion offense, if you don't get in front of them and prevent that cut, see what can happen right there.
22-13 now. Just a minute and a half left in this first quarter. Post up. Back bucket doesn't go, but it's going to be free throws.
Well, that was a great job by the Hoyas of recognizing. See the previous trip down by the Blue Jays. Nice job by the Hoyas on their offensive end to recognize the mismatch they got with the switch. When Batchelor, who was guarding right, got switched off and ended up with Temi Sarda at 5'9", guarding the 6'1 right, giving away the inches and the size to right in the post.
Right. Missed that one. She was 62% coming into the game, went 1 of 2. And Creighton up 22-14. Agnew. Tightly guarded by Tiana Jones. Lob feed inside. It's Batchelor again. Tiana Jones got a hand on the ball and a hand on Carly Batchelor as well.
Good slip recognition there by Agnew. You see the slip from Batchelor. Jones tried to recover. Did get the block, but also picked up the foul there. Carly Batchelor to the line. She won a Big East Freshman of the Week honor this year, putting together back-to-back double-doubles one weekend against Butler and Xavier, earned her that honor. Another glimpse into what the future holds for the Blue Jays.
Last year's Kansas Miss basketball.
Yeah, she's quite an athlete too. Not just Miss basketball, but she's an all-sport type of athlete, and that has really translated very well here in the Big East for the Jays.
Misses the second. Georgetown nearly throws it out of bounds.
They're almost getting sped up on their own, and no pressure by the Blue Jays, but Georgetown wanting to move fast.
Under a minute now. The shot from Brianna Jones off the rim. Rebound comes to Agnew.
Jones trying to see if she could continue over that 24-point night, 10 of 16 on Friday night.
Bounce pass. Batchelor again gets in deep, but can't finish. Brodsky with the offensive board. Still 25 seconds remain. Agnew, head fake, back to Brodsky, open for three, offline, pulled out of there by Jones. She tried to throw a pass ahead, Brodsky stole it, and scores at the rim with 8 seconds to go in the first.
And Jones trying to start the counterattack, if you will, a little bit out of control and picked up her feet, had to get rid of it. Brodsky was the beneficiary of the steal and the finish.
One quarter in the books, Creighton up 11, 25-14. Got 10 more minutes before the half. Women's basketball coming at you here on the Big East Digital Network by SoFi. Needs 23 points today to have a regular season scoring average of 20.
She's well on her way. Well on her way. Well, yeah, I mean, that'll move it up for now. No, can't just keep it in the postseason.
Cool.
Great.
Second quarter just about to get started here from Cole Arena. Here's Jaylyn Agnew, a senior out of Andover, Kansas, five-time player of the week in the Big East this season. She's got 10 first quarter points up.
Yeah, nobody has won it more than her this year, and that's a school record to win five-time conference player of the week, and she has just had a tremendous career. You see those stats there. She will be the 11th player to eclipse 1,500, and she included a 38-point game earlier this season, and she was 4 points away from the school record for a single game with 8 minutes to play. She's such an unselfish player. She only took one shot the rest of the way and ended with those ho-hum 38 points.
Osagi Aresi starts things in a second with Georgetown with a bucket, and then a foul under the basket. Carly Batchelor hitting the deck.
Batchelor with another offensive rebound for the Blue Jays. Keeps the offensive possession alive.
That was Tayana Jones called for the foul. Already her third. Three on the way from Brodsky. A little bit long. They'll start back the other way. There's Osagi Aresi. It's to the basket, back-to-back buckets for the senior out of East Orange, New Jersey.
And she's a good story, too, as well. She played in a total of 23 games. Speaking of good stories.
From way downtown, that's 1,500 for Jaylyn Agnew, plus one for good measure.
She is such a tremendous shooter. I've been covering Creighton for 20 years, and I don't know that I can remember a better, more pure shooter that Coach Flannery has had.
Tried to answer at the other end. Pointer off the mark. Creighton back to the offense.
And you clearly, obviously, don't need me to say she's a pure shooter when we talked about her shooting percentages at the free throw. And not only is she en route to setting a Big East free throw percentage record, she leads the NCAA in free throw percentage.
Here's Elger. Brodsky. Good bounce pass. Batchelor cutting to the rim again.
And Creighton appears to have found a hole in the Georgetown defense, and Coach Howard sees it as well, and he needs a timeout to address it.
8:24 left in the second. Creighton 30, Georgetown 18. Finish the second quarter on the other side. 30-18, Creighton in the lead. Tracy and Jay Agnew made the trip up from Andover, Kansas to see their daughter on senior day here at Sokol Arena.
It's got to be a little bittersweet to make that last drive to see your daughter play and complete a career, a home career. Of course, her career is not going to be complete for another few weeks, but nearing the end of the road for this outstanding senior.
And stripped by Agnew at the other end. Elger. And Rembau. Agnew will take another deep three. That one's a little short. Now 3 for 5 from outside.
Well, as Agnew has gone this year, so have the Jays. The Jays 14-1 on the season when she leads the team in scoring. Talked about her leading the way in the Big East. Leading scorer at 19.9 points per game.
Elger surveys. She'll bring it to the top and reset. 7 on the shot clock for Agnew. Elger will take the long two, but it's swatted out of her hands. Sarda with the pickup. Got it to touch the rim, but that was all. Brianna Jones secures it.
Georgetown making that defensive adjustment as Coach Howard called the timeout. He didn't like all the cuts that were getting through. Creighton was getting some easy looks inside. They clogged the lane there a little bit and caused essentially what was a turnover for the Jays.
Kalava tried the backdoor pass, and Elger going to be called for the hook. On Taylor Barnes.
Yeah, absolutely right. Kalava saw Barnes streaking across here, and you see the foul. It was almost because the pass was underthrown that Barnes had to go towards the ball, and that went forced her to move into Elger. Nonetheless, the contact not permitted.
Kalava trying to erase 2.5 minutes of scoreless basketball. She does it with the turnaround off the glass.
One of the players that Coach Howard talked about seeing that effort, seeing that growth, has been Kalava. She leads the league in blocked shots and right up there in rebounds as well. 5th in the league in rebounds. She's got one more year of eligibility. Could be a big, big-time player for Georgetown next year.
Could be a key piece in the rebuild next year for James Howard. Underneath, bounce pass, got it. Gracie Griglione finishes.
That wasn't even bad defense by Georgetown. That was such a great find by Temi Sarda to be able to pass it through the defenders that had collapsed onto her, and a great job by Griglione to slip to the basket.
Kalava, second time she's been called for the travel on the takeoff.
Yeah, Kalava averaging those 6 points per game. Coach Howard talked about her ability to score at a season high 15 earlier in the year. And she has the ability, it's just the ability to have the confidence. She's working on her confidence of her offensive game. She's got the defensive game down, now it's offense.
Straight on three for Agnew. Missed it, touched out of bounds. Last touch by Sarda. Georgetown ball, 32-20. Creighton up 12.
Agnew only scored 3 points in the first half the first time these teams met. She scored 20 in the second half. Nothing of the sort today for her.
Barnes with the jumper, got it. 10-point game. Griglione. Agnew. Saunders, who scored 10 or more in the last three, called for the travel.
Yeah, Saunders has really picked up her game. It started actually when Agnew went down with an injury, missed 4 games, and Saunders stepped in and played some of the best ball of her career. Continued on. Friday night, she tied a Sokol Arena record with 6 steals.
Offensive foul. It's going to be a moving screen as Saunders was trying to interrupt the handoff, and she was bumped. Sagi Oresi called for the foul.
Jays have cooled off a little bit here in the second quarter.
Agnew, another three. That one's good. 16 points for Jaylyn Agnew. Still nearly 5 minutes left in the first half.
She scored 20 points in three of her last four. Looking like fourth 20-point performance is en route.
A little short hop jumper from Osagie Aresi. At 8 points.
Yeah, 8 points, and she only averages about five, and she's found herself open, taking advantage of those looks.
Leon wants to get in on the three-point party, but leaves that one short. On the run out, Kalava. Good pass from the point guard of Sagi Aresi.
Yeah, I started to mention it earlier, but Agnew stayed too hot. We couldn't finish the thought. Osagie Aresi, 23 games total in her first three seasons. That's all. She stuck with it, and now she has started in 20 of the 24 games she's played this year.
Jaylyn Agnew with another three. It is her fifth three-point basket of the first half.
Unbelievable shooter.
19 points.
Her shot is so pure. The rotation on it is so pure. The way she follows through.
And the answer with one at the other end. That's Grace Ann Bennett, a freshman. James Howard is pretty high on, says this is not a good matchup for her today. Thinks she can really help build for the future. Jaylyn Agnew, my goodness. Feeling it here on her last home game.
We talked about that 38-point game, and that was not a high-volume game for her either. She was 14 of 21 from the field in that one, 7 of 11 from three-point range.
Agnew has it stripped on the drive, able to recover. Sarda finds Saunders. Elger back to Saunders. She'll take the three. It's blocked into the hands of Batchelor. The baseline jumper is good. Boy, better to be lucky than good sometimes.
Batchelor just happened to be in the right place at the right time to come down with that blocked shot.
40-26, 14 points, the largest lead of this first half for Creighton. Good head fake from Osagie Aresi, but couldn't get it to go. Then there's a scramble on the floor, and it's finally tied up.
This effort by all involved there. Grace Ann Bennett in there for the Hoyas. You see that basket by Batchelor. Clock was running down on the shot clock. Had just about 4 seconds left, so smart decision by the freshman rather than restarting the possession. Taking advantage and knowing the situation.
Batchelor now with 7 points after the make. Georgetown trying to cut into the lead. Under 3 minutes to go in the first half. Size advantage on the floor right now for the Hoyas. Kalava. Osagie Aresi. The turnaround from Kalava, and that's pure.
There's that confidence we're talking about. 6'3", she's going to have size advantage on almost every player she matches up against in the Big East, especially today here in Omaha.
Kalava's had 10 in three of her last five, and there's a foul before the shot by Agnew. Pushing through the screen, called on Brianna Jones.
See Elger trying to set up her fellow classmate.
It's team foul number three on Georgetown.
We've seen a lot of prototypical Agnew today. That was prototypical Elger. That's what she does. She sacrifices her body for this team more than any other.
Foul on the shot clock, lost by Sarda. Agnew stepping through. Wow.
What can you say?
Marvelous.
What can you say? 21 points already in this ball game, and you know it's your day when stuff like that's going in.
42-28. Osagie Aresi with the teardrop. Speaking of marvelous, that's her first name.
Fantastic, and just two off her career high now.
Agnew with the feed inside. Carly Batchelor now with 9 points.
Again, you have a player who scored 21, so you have every right, and that's the right decision if you're Georgetown. We better collapse on her, but guess what? She has the court vision as well to find her open teammate when she gets collapsed on and double-teamed.
Bennett on the block. Strong finish from the freshman. All-time leader in points and rebounds at Lake George High School. More than 2,000 points and 1,500 rebounds in her high school career. You see why James Howard is excited. What a finish from Jaylyn Agnew. It just doesn't stop. Every time down the floor, she's doing something spectacular.
I mean, if you're Georgetown right now, you're down 14. You've made 7 of your last 9 shots have the Hoya. So they haven't been slouching on offense. But when you have the all-conference caliber performance that Agnew's putting together.
Now Taylor Barnes knocks down a tray at the other end. Got a high-scoring first half here at Sokol.
Yeah, both sides now have hit their last 4 shots. Georgetown, you know how shooting is contagious sometimes. It's been contagious on both teams here down the stretch.
Smart play right there as the Blue Jays let the ball roll in the backcourt, not because they thought the clock was going to stop, but to run time so that the shot clock turned off and they get to hold for a final shot.
Really heads up play by the Blue Jays.
8 seconds to go, Elger to Agnew. Agnew, 23 points. Outside, 3 from Sarda, got it! With 2 on the game clock, and that's the half. The Blue Jays radioactive from 3-point range in the first half, lead at 49-35 over the Hoyas. We got much more coming at the break. Hope you'll stick around with us. It's Creighton by 14. Back with you at the half from DJ Sokol Arena on the campus of Creighton University. The Blue Jays lead at 49-35 over the Hoyas of Georgetown. Thank you for joining us here today on the Big East Digital Network, presented by SoFi. John Schreiner, Rob Sims with you. Rob, Creighton put on a great shooting performance in that first half, and Georgetown wasn't even bad.
Unbelievable to me that Georgetown shot better than 70% in the second quarter, and they lost 4 points off the lead because Creighton continued to shoot lights out as well.
Let's take a look at the first half statistics here between Georgetown and Creighton. Look at that, Georgetown, almost 56% from the field. You'll take that every time, but when your opponent's shooting almost 60%, what do you do?
That's just incredible. And you see the 8 for 17 from three-point range for the Blue Jays. And you mentioned it before we get back on air. 19 field goals the Blue Jays have hit, 16 have been assisted. So we mentioned at one point when Coach Howard had to call that timeout, because of the movement that this motion offense has for the Blue Jays, Georgetown wasn't able to stay with it, and the Blue Jays were hitting all of their cutters, finishing inside those outside buckets that they were hitting because they were penetrating and kicking out for an open look from the outside. Georgetown just didn't have the answer defensively. Now offensively, you see the numbers, shooting fantastic, but just defensively a struggle there for Georgetown in the first half.
Well, we could be in for a high-scoring affair here at the Sokol Arena. We'll have the highlights from the first half when we come back. Halftime between the Hoyas and Blue Jays. Creighton with a 14-point advantage. Let's see if we can figure out how we got there, Rob Sims. Look at the first half highlights.
We'll take a look first at what the Hoyas were able to do. They were able to get some inside looks to see Osagie Arese. She's only 2 points off her career high right now, with 10 points in the first half, 12 to her career high, and the nice turnaround jumper by Anita Kalava. But for the Blue Jays, it's not only just the Blue Jay highlights, it's the Agnew package, because of what the fifth-year senior has done on her senior night, dropping these three-point bombs from every angle, five of them in the first half, 23 points for the senior in the opening half. Just an unbelievable performance by Agnew and the Blue Jays in finding her.
In her 25th game of the season, 500 points now on the year for Jaylyn Agnew. One more break here at the half. 49-35, Blue Jays up. After 20 minutes of basketball, the Blue Jays have a 14-point lead on the Hoyas here on the final day of the regular season. John Schreiner, Rob Sims along with you for this senior day from Creighton University. Jaylyn Agnew putting on a show here today in her final game in the building. And the standings, well, we told you from the outset, there was a logjam in the middle of the conference. Four teams at 10-7, all trying to find their way into that four spot. Here they are. DePaul at the top, Marquette probably going to stay in the two. Butler at three, not safe. And then Villanova, Creighton, Seton Hall, St. John's. Any one of them could be playing in the play-in round by getting the seven seed.
And you see our guys in the trunk have already updated with that Villanova win over Providence, so they are done at 11-7. The good news for Creighton, they swept Villanova, so we knew coming into today, out of all the scenarios, if Creighton walks out of here with a victory, they would not be playing in the play-in game because they would have that tiebreaker with Villanova. And Seton Hall and St. John's, of course, still trying to avoid that seventh seed, so they avoid playing on opening night.
The only other scenario that we knew for sure is if all the 10-7 teams won, Villanova would be the 7th seed by virtue of the tiebreakers. Let's take a look at the scores from around the league. There you see it. Villanova with a 74-63 win over Providence. That moved them to 11-7. Seton Hall currently 66-51, the lead over Butler. And as we told you, Butler was not safe in that 3 spot. Again, the tiebreak scenarios, they're all wild and convoluted. It's really unclear as to what needs to happen for Butler to fall out of the three, but a loss to Seton Hall would be mandatory.
Yeah, and Seton Hall, of course, would finish 11-7, and St. John's has the lower team in Xavier later this afternoon. So those four teams could all finish 11-7, and then the Big East office gets to have some fun with the tiebreakers.
Teams back out on the floor. We got 20 more minutes of basketball. Creighton and Georgetown when we come back. Right back to action here, second half underway. Blue Jays begin with the basketball. Jaylyn Agnew begins with a three-pointer.
Unbelievable. You know, I mentioned it, 38 points with 8 minutes to play against Providence, a shot at the single game scoring record. You don't assume that she thinks she's gonna go out there and do it in her final home game, but my goodness, it certainly looks like she has that possession in her eyes right now.
Anita Kalava gets an and one opportunity at the other end for Georgetown. Kalava, 81% from the line. A former of the Croatian national team. There's James Howard talking things over with his grad transfer senior.
We talked about Kalava and her abilities leading the league in blocked shots, fifth in rebounds. Over 100 blocked shots for her in two seasons with the Hoyas.
Missed the free throw. Comes Creighton. On the right wing, wide open for three is Sarda. Missed that one. And Brianna Jones for the rebound. Usagi Aresi, who had 10 first half points. Into the lane. That was Cassandra Gordon who mishandled it. Sarda, she'll take another three. That one's good. Missed on the previous possession. Made no mistake right there.
Yeah, Sarda's knocked down 48 triples now with her two today. Deadly shooter from the outside.
Leads up to 55-37 now for Creighton. And it's lost at the other end by Barnes.
Yeah, just mishandled by Barnes there, dribbling into traffic.
Rembau Elger. It's the handoff back from Griglione. Seven on the shot clock, into the hands of Agnew. She'll take it straight on. That one was almost down too.
They hear the oohs and ahs from the crowd here. They want to see something special. They know they've already seen something special. The more she continues to shoot, the more you think that something even more special might happen today for the Blue Jay senior.
Foul called on Sarda as Osagi Arese into the lane. She'll go to the free throw line. 71% foul shooter on the season.
And just to reiterate, she's one of the team captains of sticking with it, sticking through the process. She played 23 total games in her first three seasons.
And now this, a walk-on.
This is her 20th start this year, and she's played in all 24 games and averages 5 points, three rebounds. Just a great team player to have for the Hoyas.
She's a walk-on, earned her scholarship this year. 1-for-2 at the line there. Agnew on the dribble, gets in deep, and one. .28 points for Jaylyn Agnew.
She had an open look for a second from three, but her feet weren't quite set and ready to go, so she decided to take it inside and give herself a chance at this old-fashioned three-point play, which is almost guaranteed as the three-pointer once again.
Well, that makes 48 in a row from the free throw line. She's working on her third 30-point game of the season. Calava from the baseline, just missed it. Creighton by 20. Rembau from the corner. Off long into the hands of Gordon. Aressi in the lane, got it. Friendly roll here at Sokol Arena.
Well, in her final regular season game of her career, she sets a career high for scoring. So we're talking about the other side, Agnew all day. Osagi Arese with a new career high, 13 points.
6 of 9 from the floor. Agnew on the dribble, draws the contact. Gordon will come out. That's Tayana Jones coming in. Sophomore out of Selma, North Carolina. Elger to Agnew with 10 on the shot clock. Rembau into the lane, puts up the shot. Too strong, offensive board, put back is good for Gracie Griglione.
Gracie Griglione started every game this year, but you don't talk about her all that much. She hasn't played more than 15 minutes in any of those starts, which is just talks about what Flan wants on the floor for his personnel.
Lava on the cut, able to finish.
Lava with the nice finish, but Griglione, she'll chip in every once in a while and get those putbacks, and those are just, those 4 points are important, those that she's able to contribute. She averages just about 2.5 per game.
It's now 4 of 6 that Anita Calava scored in double figures. Griglione has the shot blocked as she was going up.
By a 5'4" marvelous player right now.
She takes it the other way and scores on the layup without hardly jumping.
She's feeling it right now. When you block a, you're a 5'4" player and you get the switch onto you, guarding against that 6'1" player, you get a block, you're feeling it. And when you got a career high, you feel like you can go down and put it away. Good for her.
15 points, 7 of 10 from the floor.
She did it again, pokes it away on the mismatch.
From Griglione, but this time it's a foul. Did they call the foul or just
I think
it
just got poked out of bounds.
No foul.
It was a clean
well
play
done.
Once again. Here
Take
we go.
A look.
Yeah.
And you all see ball.
If Griglione could start a little higher, she keeps it away from the smaller player.
Agnew on the drive, and she's got 31.
Well, we hadn't seen that yet today. We hadn't seen the left-handed finish yet, so Agnew had to show the fans and Soak Larina that one more time.
62-44, Creighton. Shot from Barnes is off the mark. Parra pulls it out, sprinting the other way. She'll stop. Wait for some help to arrive. Parra on the catch underneath, took her eyes off the ball, I think, looking for the extra pass. And it's out of bounds.
High pass there. And see Agnew slice to the basket and the finish lefty to get into 31 points.
That gets us to the media timeout with 5 minutes remaining in the third. Jaylyn Agnew with 31 points. We still got 15 minutes to play. Creighton up 62-44. Blue Jays up 62-44. Jaylyn Agnew with 31 points. Only two players in Creighton's history have scored 40 points in a game. Kathy Halligan did it three times in the 1990 season. Agnew may be trending in that direction, and it's a three at the other end. Brianna Jones, they count it as a two.
Put just inside the arc. Officials had it right off the shot.
Connie Yori was the other Blue Jay to score. She has the single game record at 42 points. Here's Barham under the basket, scores.
Barham showing that athleticism.
Brianna Jones, can she get something going? There's Tayana Jones. From the free throw line, a little bit short. Offensive board, put back is good. Shania Wright. The offensive board and the stick back.
Right, the sophomore out of Brooklyn. Some minutes out there, a little more extended minutes than she was used to seeing earlier in the year.
And there's Sarda on the cut to the rim. Another assist for Jaylyn Agnew. She's got five of those to go along with four rebounds.
Agnew. Oh, and by the way, 31 points. Six of 10 shooting from the outside.
Barnes missed it. It's off the foot of Kalava out of bounds.
You always want senior day to be a celebration. Obviously, you honor your seniors before or after the game, depending on the program. The Blue Jays here will honor their seniors after the game. You want it to be a celebration within the game, too. It doesn't always play out that way, but my goodness, hard not to gush about what Jaylyn Agnew is doing today.
There she is. Gives it to Sarda. Sarda bounced down to Batchelor. And on the shot clock, here's Saunders. Batchelor, and it's traveled.
Just picked up that pivot foot just ever so slightly. Trying to get in there as the shot clock was ticking down.
Tay Jones from the baseline. Going too deep off the side of the backboard. Agnew crossover, kick. Now Sarda, Agnew in the corner. Three, missed it. And a foul.
Even Agnew's threes are a thing of beauty. I mean, every time that she's missed, it's been, you know, a half an inch or a fraction of an inch away from reaching the bottom of the net. And I say every time she's missed, it's only five times in 16 shots today. Just that pure release we were talking about from the get-go.
Barnes into the lane, hangs, and draws the contact.
Barnes going to go to the free throw line. She's third in the Big East in free throw shooting this year. Career best 83% in her career at Memphis coming into this year. Just under an 80% free throw shooter. And this year up to 80%. Almost 83% at the line.
Well, she's done it quite a bit, 76 and 92, make it 77 of 93.
She's really stepped up her shooting, not only at the free throw line, but she was an under 30% three-point shooter at Memphis in those 3 years, and coming into today, shooting from 37% from the outside. She's really needed every bit of her scoring and offense throughout this year.
Agnew gets by a defender. An air ball. There's a collector's item.
That's the first two she's missed today.
Nine on the shot clock. Agnew inside. Got that one to go. Makes it 33. 68-50. Creighton by 18. Kay Jones for three. Well offline. Into the hands of Brodsky. Eaton Brodsky worked around the perimeter. Agnew missed another three. It's tapped out. It'll stay on this end. So Creighton, Rob Sims, they've got 18 wins, trending towards 19. They've got 10 losses. They've got some quality wins. Question is, do they have an at-large bid sealed up?
That depends on who you talk to. You know that obviously today was a must-win, and barring a collapse, it looks like that will likely happen. Now, what can they do in the Big East tournament? A nice finish by Brodsky. Do they need to win one in the Big East tournament? Do they need to win two? There's no doubt they need to win at least one more. Do they need to win two more in the Big East? Do they need to get to the Big East Finals in order to really feel secure about an at-large bid?
Agnew for three. Got that one. Give her all three and make it 36. She's 2 points from her career high of 38.
Now, when you leave her this wide open, the last couple of threes she's attempted had been a quick release. This time, she had a chance to gather herself, get her legs under her with a nice, clean release.
52.3 seconds left in the third. Jaylyn Agnew putting on a show for senior day. 73-50 the score. Jaylyn Agnew with what is perhaps a record book kind of day for Creighton here today. Already 36 points. She's six off the single game record for the Blue Jays. Quickly break the press, and Kalava's under the basket to take advantage.
I wonder if that's a wrinkle Flan just wants to work on for the postseason, because that's not something that the Jays typically will do. And it was a wrinkle that did not work for the Jays on that trip down. It worked well for the Hoyas.
Creighton trying to get that shot clock to turn off once again here at the end of the quarter. Didn't quite get it, but it's very close. Rembau's going to hold for a final shot. Batchelor in the high post, hands off to Agnew. Agnew, the double team along the baseline, outside for Rembau, 4-3. Missed it off the rim. We're through three quarters here at Sokol Arena. Creighton 73, Georgetown 52. Blue Jays in complete control with 10 minutes to go.
One quarter to go, Blue Jays up 21 on the Hoyas of Georgetown here on the final day of the regular season.
So much on the line as far as standings. Creighton doing their part to keep themselves in that four slot conversation. Sagi Arisi into the lane, draws the foul. 15 points on 7 of 10 shooting. Osagi Arisi. Osagi Arisi, 71% from the line this season. First one's good.
She's enjoyed both games against the Blue Jays this year. Maybe not from a team perspective, but personally. Scored above her season average in both meetings with the Blue Jays.
Make it
17 points now for Osagie Eresi. Batchelor outside the arc, trying to get it into Agnew, but it was touched away.
Agnew had the mismatch there, but pass just didn't get far enough away.
Osagie Eresi will take the three, missed it. Jaylyn Agnew now with her seventh rebound. She's got 36, seven rebounds, and six assists.
Pretty decent day.
You'll take it. There's Brodsky. Agnew, step back three. Lift out.
Again, just, she doesn't miss offline. It's either a little long or a little short. She does not miss offline.
Kalava outside, Brianna Jones for three. Got it. Good shot for Brianna Jones.
Inside out action by Georgetown. Nice look on the offensive end for the Hoyas.
Jones has been shooting the three pretty well over her last three games. She's been 7 of 13 from beyond the arc. Continuing that here today. Agnew, 10 on the shot clock. Sarda now with 7, with 6. Puts up the shot. Off the rim, no good. Nice touched by Batchelor.
See if we get an overturn here. Yep, we will. So Creighton will maintain possession.
Jim Flannery on the bench got up to protest and started to be very vocal and then kind of calmed down and said, oh, wait, never mind. We're up by a lot. And a bucket and the foul. Demi Sarda. Good bounce feed from Rimbaugh.
Finish with the offhand by Sarda. Sarda, 13 points per game this season, 4.5 rebounds. It's just been outstanding for the Jays. She had scored in double figures in 10 straight games before Friday night, scored 8 on Friday, but so now in double figures for the 11th time in 12 games this year. Double figures 21 times for Sarda. She's really an X factor. The junior duo of Rembau and Sarda, those guards, how good can they be complementing what Agnew does? That could determine how deep the Blue Jays go into either the Big East tournament or the NCAA tournament this year for the Blue Jays.
Well, certainly Jaylyn Agnew is going to be in the conversation for Big East Player of the Year. Who were some other names that stick out to you, Rob?
Well, I think there's a pair of players for DePaul that might be helpful to Agnew's chances of winning the Player of the Year, just because potential to split votes there. Kelly Campbell, obviously the all-around game that she has for DePaul. And then Shante Stonewall, obviously, probably you're looking at the best player on the best team in the Big East. And then I really, really like, I don't know that she'll get it, but Selena Lott, I love her game for Marquette. The way that she controls the pace of the game, I love the way she plays defense. But to me, the way Agnew has scored, the way she has an all-around game, it's not just the points tonight. You've mentioned it a couple times, John. It's not just those 36 points. It's not a high volume that she scores in, but she does other things. Those 7 rebounds, 6 assists this afternoon kind of highlights her all-around game. Now, Selena Lott has that all-around game as well. And Shante Stonewall is an outstanding player. It'll be interesting to see who wins the Big East Player of the Year. And you see this long review here trying to determine. Look like Sarda's right arm up a little high there, John.
Yeah, the officials have gone to the monitor. They're checking it over, see if Sarda got the elbow up into the face of Brianna Jones. And this is a long look that the officials are taking here. And now all three of them are going to have a peek.
Just gives us more time to talk about Jaylyn Agnew, right? Her outstanding season. But really, honestly, I mean, I think it could be any of those players. And if any of them win and the other one doesn't, whoever doesn't win, it's not like it's going to be a snub. Those are all outstanding candidates. To me, the season that obviously having a front row seat to a lot of what Agnew has done here in Omaha this year and throughout her career, the former freshman of the year in the Big East, and leading the league in scoring, she has just made an impact. Jays are 14-1 on the season when she leads her team in scoring. And to me, she has maybe a little bit of an edge to win the Big East Player of the Year. And obviously, Shante Stonewall, Selena Lott, also outstanding players. Kelly Campbell, very good for DePaul as well. We'll see what the decision here is.
The call is nothing. We're going to get the official explanation over here. No intentional foul. Stays as called. And Temi Sarda at the line for an and one. It's good. Bringing up 76-57. Temi Sarda now with 13 points. She is the only other Blue Jay in double figures. It's been the Jaylyn Agnew show today. Barnes with the jumper, got the friendly roll.
Barnes had plenty of space there to get that shot off.
She's the third Hoya into double figures. She's got 11 now. Here's Sarda. Agnew, guarded by Barnes. Turnaround from the elbow.
Wow.
Got it. 38 points now for Jaylyn Agnew.
Ties her career high, which she put up just a couple of weeks ago at Providence. So she does it for the home crowd now.
Sagi Aresi. Kalava, mismatch on Elger, and the foul comes. Kalava couldn't finish.
It's a heady play there by Kalava, though. She was going against the shorter defender. It's almost like a sidearm, a pitcher that throws sidearm. She brought the ball down by her side to bring that ball up. It wasn't a scoop shot, but the way she went up with that, she initiated the contact. Really smart play there, Elger picking up the foul.
We're calling that the windmill hook.
Yeah, I like that. Kind of a modified version of maybe a James Worthy type
right.
of look.
Yeah.
Maybe not a Kareem Sky hook.
It's halfway between a hook shot and a windmill dunk. Lava 2-for-2.
So it's Agnew and Kathy Halligan now, the only players in school history to have two games of 38 or more points in their career. Halligan, of course, well, not of course, I guess if you're not familiar
not
with the program, not familiar with the program, Halligan, the all-time leading scorer for the Blue Jays with over 2,100 points, so you figured she'd have a few of those days in there.
40 points three different times in the 1990 season. How about that? Off the rebound, rimbound to Agnew. Now Elger, she'll spot up for three. A little bit short, offensive board for the Blue Jays. 17-point advantage for the home team. Lob in for Agnew. It was behind her from Elger.
Yeah, Elger knew it right when she let go of it. She didn't put the pace on it that she needed to. She thought potentially that Agnew would be stopping her cut to the basket at that point, and instead Agnew continued. And she apologized. Elger apologized to her classmate there.
Gordon. Anna Jones. Asagi Aresi. Driving inside, blocked by Agnew.
Just devastating her all-around game today. We just wants to put it out there for the voters.
Left corner three, Agnew was offline. Well, her teammates really want her to get to 40 today, don't they? On the drive, Barnes is fouled. We'll go for two shots.
Well, I think the thing that was so interesting in that game against Providence a couple weeks ago when she had those 38 points, she got to 38. With 8 minutes left in the ball game, she shot one more time the rest of the day. And it wasn't because her teammates weren't getting her the ball. She was just being unselfish, and she was playing within the flow of the game. She wasn't trying to do maybe what Kobe Bryant did in his final game on the court. She wasn't saying, feed me, I'm going to get what I can get. She was just playing within the flow of the offense, and it just happened to be the shots weren't there for her, so she continued to, she was on the court, but she just kept passing out of potential scoring situations. see what she does today.
A couple of made free throws for Taylor Barnes, makes it 78-63. Sarda. There's Agnew in the post. Mismatch, turnaround, she's fouled. She'll go to the line with a chance to get to 40.
Chance for 40 at the free throw line where she has not missed since December 8th. You know, you got to figure some announcer along the way these last 3 months potentially could have jinxed it, right? Are we going to be the ones to jinx it?
I don't think so.
I see her parents there. 1 point away from 40.
There it is. 40 points on the day for Jaylyn Agnew. She's the third player in Creighton history to reach the 40-point mark.
And those shots, not even do they miss the rim, they barely even ripple the net. They're so pure.
Barnes, good. Great mid-range jumper from Taylor Barnes.
I know you're down 15 on the road, but if you're Coach Howard, I like the way they've been playing offense for the Hoyas.
Rembaugh strokes the three. Early in the possession, and the Blue Jays have 83. Barnes. Got it to Jones, who missed the long three. Now, here's Saunders. Elger. Agnew. Two away from the school record. She'll try to break it right there. It was off the mark. Here's Barnes. She'll spot up a three at the other end. Left it short. Agnew with the rebound. Rebound number 9 for Jaylyn Agnew.
How'd you like to have a 40-point double-double?
How about it?
And she's got 4.5 minutes to make it happen. You can kind of sense that. That's what's happening right now is I think her teammates know, I think she knows.
For the record, Jaylyn Agnew got it. 43 points for Jaylyn Agnew, a new school record.
They set her up, she's open. Knocks down her 8th triple of the game to eclipse the school record. 43 points for the 5th-year senior in her final home game. Outstanding.
In December of 1982, Connie Yori scored 42 points for the Blue Jays, and now more than 38 years later, her record has been broken. Jaylyn Agnew with 43 points, the new all-time leader in single-game points for Creighton.
Connie sitting courtside as a program advisor, the Creighton Hall of Famer, the former Creighton player, Creighton head coach, now back as a program advisor. You see her there getting to take in, and she was all smiles in the huddle there for the Blue Jays after her record was broken by Jaylyn Agnew. Connie, one of two jerseys retired in program history, tells you the influence that she has and the clout that she has amongst this program. Outstanding basketball player and coach and person.
86-68 to score after the couple of made free throws. Here's Elger. Now Sarda. And Bao. Sarda will take the three. She's fouled on the three-point shot. It's going to be three free throws for Temi Sarda. 3:41 to go in the game.
Well, we speculated about how much longer Agnew will be in there. Yet imagine Coach Flannery will sub her out at some point to a rousing ovation. Still want to see an appearance from Morgan Turner, the senior who's been out all year with the injury. She's riding the stationary bike right now, trying to get her legs loose enough to get out there for 30 seconds for the Blue Jays. You see Morgan there on the bike. We talked about her a little bit earlier, but just unable to play this year because of a back injury. And just hearing an interview with her this year, she said no doubt in her mind it was the right decision because of the pain that she is in and still continues to be. And even though she hasn't played this year, the back pain was just too much to continue to try to fight through it.
All three good for Temi Sarda. Makes it 89-68. Blue Jays back ahead by more than 20. Gordon, here's Calava. Tay Jones trying to feed it inside. Saunders tucks it away momentarily. Asagi Aresi unable to convert. And Tatum Rembau with the rebound. Elger for three. Missed it, a little bit long. And Anita Calava, as she's done so many times this year, comes up with the rebound. Calava with a couple of double-doubles this season. Outside, three on the way for Barnes, and that one's good. Taylor Barnes now with 21 points. And a timeout for Jim Flannery. As Morgan Turner is going to check in with 2 minutes and 44 seconds to go.
Just a quick timeout for the substitution to get Turner on the floor. The transfer, she's a 6'2 forward from Kentucky, Gustin, Kentucky. Transferred in from Lipscomb. Played 27 games last year. Has not appeared on the floor at all until this point this season.
And look at her. Just a huge smile on the face of Morgan Turner right now. Three-pointer, got it! How about it? Morgan Turner on senior day, able to knock down a shot. Jumper at the other end for Gordon, gets her own rebound. Jones will jack the three. Missed it off the glass. And a foul underneath. They're going to get Agnew.
Well, you think about how much time and energy these young ladies have put into the game of basketball, not just this year, not just over the last 4 years, but over their life, about how much effort and a part of their life this has been. And that's a really cool moment for Morgan Turner to come out there and not only play, but get to nail a three.
Barnes with the second free throw. It's off. Rebound for Calava. Put back is good. Calava now with 16. Under 2 minutes to play. Blue Jays have cracked 90. Saunders with eight on the shot clock. Puts up the three. Tapped out. Asagi or SA. Yeah. Barnes in among the trees, got the scoop to go. Taylor Barnes now has 24. She's just two off her season high. For 26 points at Seton Hall.
Might be seeing the seniors come off the floor here.
That's Morgan Turner. He got in there for a good minute and a half. Able to knock down a tray, gets the big hug from Jim Flannery. That'll be her final act as a Blue Jay.
Pretty awesome final act. Knowing that her back injury kept her out all season long, but able to put on the uniform one last time for the Blue Jays.
Looks like Jaylyn Agnew is going to get all 40 minutes out of this one.
Well, they just sent two subs to the scorer's table, so they'll get Elger and Agnew out together when they get a chance.
Elger, eight on the shot clock. Brodsky back to Elger with three, with two. Left-handed shot from Elger falls. Wow. When they're falling, they're falling.
You could not script this any better. This is Elger's last act as a Blue Jay on her home floor as she will check out now along with Agnew. So she gets a bucket in her final minutes on the floor. Agnew sets a program record for scoring, and Turner scores the first time she touches the ball this season. You could not possibly script this any better for the Blue Jays.
Creighton's made 15 threes in this game. Barnes at the other end, we're under a minute to play. It was Dee Dee Pryor and Chloe Dworick who checked in for Creighton. Calava, good cut from Gordon to the rim, and she scores.
Nice back screen there set by Tyana Jones to open up the cutter. Good find there by the Hoyas.
Pryor brings it ahead, shot clock is off. Creighton can dribble it out. And they're gonna get win number 19 on the season. Win number 10 in this building for the year, and they'll move to 11-7 in Big East play. Results are still pending in the rest of the conference, but Creighton has done their part to get the four seed, and Jaylyn Agnew, a new single game scoring record for Creighton with 43 points.
Blue Jays, it was a must win today. Unbelievable performance there by the fifth year senior, Jaylyn Agnew. Blue Jays put themselves in a great position to head into the Big East Conference Tournament and then into the NCAA tournament if they do enough in Chicago next weekend.
Well, this one was one for the record books for sure. Creighton gets the victory, 95-78. The next act for the Big East is the conference tournament. We head down the stretch in March. My partner, Rob Sims, our executive producer is Brad Pace. I'm John Schreiner saying so long from DJ Sokol Arena.